Hello and welcome to the Aid Station. I'm delighted today to be joined all the way from Valencia in Spain by Paco Borrell, who is the president of AIMS. And we were in fact supposed to be together with a whole other bunch of the international running community in Batumi in Georgia right these days for the AIMS annual Congress. So it's wonderful to be joining you and meeting up with you virtually. Obviously, we would love to have done it in person, Paco, but thank you so much for joining me today.
Okay, it's my pleasure. And then let's say this is the kind of, maybe the meeting we might have in a room, in a conference room in Batumi, but let's do it today.
Yeah, let's do it online.
Teleconference. Yeah, correct.
Yeah, wonderful. So I'd love you just to tell us, I mean, you've got an amazing story. You've done so much with your life. You were a very keen and capable football player when you were younger, and then you moved into running, and you've had such a massive impact on the global running community as president of AIMS. But why don't you tell us a little bit of your story in your own words, please, Paco?
Well, it's very, let's say, easy, and when you look back, you see difficult. I'm immigrant because I was born in Spain, in Zaragoza. And then we moved for economical reasons at that time to France with the family. So I went at 12 years old in France, in Toulouse. And this is where I made my studies, started to work, my military service and everything, until I moved to Montpellier and to what was my professional life in IBM in Montpellier. And then for this kind of business strategies, IBM started a manufacturing plant in Valencia. And so when I was 28, I moved to Valencia for initially 1 year. And now since 1974, I live in Valencia. So you see that year became 2-3.
Became a lifetime.
So from a professional life, I've been very much involved from, management purposes. I live 3 years in the States, in Tucson, Arizona, and Endicott in New York State. Then I live also 3 years in Paris. I went back to France at that time. And, well, Madrid, and then basically IBM closed the plant in 1985. I started an engineering company, environmental engineering company, and then the crash of 2008 came in, and it came bad for the company. It came bad at the time for me. I had a colon cancer surgery and everything. So life to recover. And since that, I moved totally to the sports. Obviously, the football times end at the 30s. And so I started the club in 1978-79. And we set up the first Valencia Marathon the 29th of March 1981. By the way, we learned 15, 20 years later, that was the same day as the London Marathon, the first London Marathon. So we had a meeting with Nick Beattle 2 weeks ago to exchange some souvenirs in London for just to share our, let's say, initiatives. And here we are. So now I have been so involved with AIMS because of my languages knowledge, because I speak French, I speak Spanish, and I speak English. So because of all the travel I talked to you. And this is my most important, let's say, background, say it, okay? So I became race director of the Valencia Marathon, more or less at the same time as it was elected different steps, the board, then the vice president in chairman in 2007, and finally president in 2010 in Athens. And since then, I'm president of AIMS, last election in Tallinn in 2019.
Wow.
Here we are. I mean, working in the working with something I love, which I say it's a work and it's not a work. Yeah. I'd say it's an activity. I mean, we all Like very much. Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. And I'm one of those. Lucky you. My job's exactly. My passion. And it's not lucky.
So we are very, very, I said, I'm very, very lucky because most of my life I've been doing what I love. I always say a very lucky man. Exactly.
And you were saying before you came on air, you love running, obviously, and you've been running around your apartment. You're locked down in Valencia at the moment. What's day-to-day life like for you at the moment? Obviously, you're on lots of conference calls. You're doing lots of Zoom. But what's a day in the life of Paco at the moment?
Well, at the moment, I mean, first of all, this is the sixth consecutive weeks we are confined at home. So I just go, let's say, to the supermarket, as you said before, I mean, to have the things used, I mean, to eat and have a normal life. But I never go out. I mean, this is the 6 weeks, and we the government now announced that we have 2 more weeks to go as confined. So it will be 8 weeks, minimum 8 weeks until. I hope we will be allowed to go running, because the fact is, at home you do walk around from the kitchen to the corridor through the dining room and things like that. But then, you know, you do let's say hundreds of tours or laps, say, in order to at least to do some kind of exercise, because let's say we all like to eat. To have a good things, so then the kilos are waiting for you if you don't take let's say the precaution. I mean, to do something. I mean, to burn it. So this is the way. So it's true. I mean, we keep the life. Let's say the outside activity through teleconferences. We have meetings. Let's say like today with you. I have meetings with different people. Let's say surrounding. The events. I have the similar things with my colleagues of the board of directors, because everything changes every day. I mean, the budgets change, the challenges change, the people asking for help, say it on some guides change. So I mean, so it's the fact is that I'm even busier than ever. Since at the beginning of that, I thought, okay, it's the right time to go to my files, to put the files in order, to make it clear, to put the labels, to organize. I didn't do it yet. It's impossible. Things come one after the other. And then everything is urgent, because it's an emergency, because people need to do something, you know, to make it. And then our children are now, our daughters are old enough to be at their home, so we are my wife Victoria and myself, I mean, say, together, and from now on we didn't fight yet, so it's fine.
That's great. I was gonna ask you if you'd learned anything that you didn't expect to learn about yourself during this period of lockdown. I guess you've confirmed that you've got lots of patience and good communication.
Exactly. Exactly. This is what I said. Well, what I learned from myself, I'm much more patient than I thought. Exactly. Yeah. This is that. I even did something. I started maybe last week. Yes. Last week I said, finally, how many years since I read the book? Nicely, quietly, etc. So I started. I'm in my second book. So I mean, this is also something, let's say, positive. I mean, from the point of view of this confinement. Yeah,
that's wonderful. And Victoria didn't come and interrupt you and give you some other jobs to do in the house. You're allowed to relax.
No. She's in the bureau. I'm in the dining room. Dining room is for me. The big table with all the papers of everything.
Your new office.
Exactly. We have 2 offices, and this is no problem. We meet for lunch.
Wonderful. That's great. It's interesting. I mean, in terms of the industry, it's a time of lots of challenges, which you've alluded to, helping lots of people through AIMS, and you know, many events going probably out of business and struggling to reschedule dates and things. And it's also a time of innovation. And I'm interested to hear if there's any interesting innovations, the way that people are coping with things, new initiatives. We're seeing lots about virtual racing, but are there any other initiatives that you've seen across the industry that's impressed you or surprised you that you think?
Listen, I told you I was, a professional working for IBM for, 25 years. Mm-hmm. And then I remember we started at that time to have an idea of how we could, to save, traffics, to save, pollutions, to save time. We started to talk about the telework. Mm-hmm. And so this is 25, 30 years ago. And then the telework went down because of technology with the mobiles, etc. So I didn't see. And now it comes in. I mean, now there is a lot of people finding that there is a possibility of telework. So it's like in myself, I that innovation build up in the early 90s. So now it's when it takes effect, mm-hmm. because of the problem of the coronavirus. It seems like you learn that you must be pushed to something to do it, mm-hmm. because if not, you're now I find myself that everything must be fast in these 2 days. I mean, if you need to write something, it's the mobile phone and then the go, and everything must be done faster and faster than yesterday and tomorrow faster than today, fast. And then when things like that happens, you see that a lot of things which have been, invented or thought many years ago is, now, when the difficulties around come, is that you go back to some of the ideas that you just push away, push aside, and then they work. Now, the teleconferences, now you have even the governments and everybody, I mean, they sit, and they have in the screen, not one, but maybe 12, 10 people, etc. And so you start. And this is what we do with the our team. We have a team in Valencia, which is the team of the club and the main sponsor. Okay, so they have a big team. So we have meetings every 3 weeks or every 2 weeks, every 3 weeks, etc., where we go through for 4 or 5 hours, and we are each one at his home, her home, and we are exchanging and making the things without moving. So if you have proposed that, 2 months ago, they would say you are crazy. And we have to meet because if we don't meet, we don't understand each other, etc. So you see that it works. Yeah. So I think the innovation 2 days, I think that the innovation we put in place to live better is something we take from the back of 20, 30 years, and they say let's now. Produce it and work it together. So this is it's unbelievable.
That's great. It's a wonderful insight. Absolutely wonderful insight.
Exactly. That's it.
Yeah. Wonderful.
And you cannot do. I mean, is the life often is something that even you can if you don't have. If you don't have a project, obviously you are not well, because all of us need personal, professional, sentimental projects. This mm-hmm. is clear. And I think that the marathon organization are based on this. I see my club, the aura on top of the club is the feelings of building something healthy, nice, solidarity, etc. On around the marathon. Mm-hmm. Okay, But then we all live free, etc. And each one thinks about something. And now is when we try to have a, they say, to have a something solid when exactly you cannot make it. Because say it's nice to meet, we cannot meet. So we have to find ways to keep the flame alive in order to think that someday we will go back and we will enjoy much more than what we do that before. That's it.
Yeah, no, that's a wonderful insight. And I always like to end on a high note with something inspirational. Obviously, with all your years in Ames, you've seen many inspiring things. I mean, what keeps you inspired? Is there a particular story that you'd like to share of something inspirational that you've seen or that keeps you inspired for those that are sitting at home listening to this?
No, you listen to me in some of the speeches. We are being in similar and common, let's say, or conferences and congresses and things like that. I often start my speeches by one sentence, which says, "Life is a survival exercise." Mm-hmm. And after that, if you have that in mind, you normally understand everybody. You might not agree, but you understand everybody. Mm-hmm. And then I think that today's all the projects we are living in are, let's say, call it group projects. I mean, teams projects. It's not something individual. It's very, very special, very rare that someone has a standalone project. I mean, maybe this is a study, this is a something academical, but normally in the where we live, either a club, either a race, either a congress, everything is always a collective stuff. So I always try, because it's my character, that I used to say that whatever we do, whatever we are, and whatever we live, let's be cautious, be fair, be smart, be friendly, and be flexible. I mean, nobody knows what tomorrow will be made of. That's the point. Make friends.
Yes.
If you make friends, you always have, whatever happens to you, you have always a way to ask for help, to give help in order to solve some problems that most of the time by yourself you will never make it. This is my way of life.
That is wonderful. That's such a great insight, and everything that I've experienced of you over the years absolutely reflects that. So we could talk for ages, but the time is right already. But so wonderful to see you, and thank you so much for making the time.
Thank you, Chris.
It's not too long before we meet again in person. But thank you so much. I wish you all the well, and I hope it really is only another 2 weeks for you before you're out there running again.
Good.
Thank you.
Good, Chris. Thank you, my friend.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye.